I tried 3 different binoviewers in 3 different telescopes. Welcome back to the Reflactor channel. Let's talk all about binoviewers. Binoculars are a great way to get into astronomy. Even a $50 set like these 10x50s can be a lot of fun. Now, if you spend more, you can get a monster set like this that magnifies up to 25 times. The only problem, of course, is that these big astronomical binoculars weigh a lot and they have to be put on a tripod. But what if you want to magnify way beyond that 25 times and still see things with both eyes? Perhaps you want to see the moon's craters or some of the brighter planets. Well, that's where binoviewers come in. They look similar to binoculars, except they only have this one tube that's coming out the front. That's because you put this into a telescope. This video is for anybody who's curious about binoviewers. Let's hit the ground running by answering the top 6 questions that people have about these. While it is true that the light is cut in half as 50% goes up this eyepiece and 50% goes up this eyepiece, the images get partially recombined in our visual cortex so that the perceived brightness is actually somewhat similar to seeing the full image with just one eye. No, since the image is the same that's being fed to each eyepiece, we technically do not see it in 3D. However, I've heard from a lot of people that use binoviewers that say when they look at the moon, it looks like a ball. Yes, binoviewers are pretty heavy, especially when you put 2 big high-quality eyepieces in there. You're going to need plenty of counterweights on your telescope. One word of warning, if you're going to put these in a diagonal on the back of a refractor, make sure that the diagonal is in there pretty tight because you don't want this to slowly rotate over and fall out. That would be a financial disaster that you might not be able to recover from. Yes, you'll need 2 identical eyepieces. Now, some binoviewers come with the eyepieces and some don't. As you can imagine, this can start to add up pretty quickly. For me, yes, I have personally found this to be true. Because we have stereo vision, when we use both of our eyes to look at something, our combined views do seemingly perceive more details. Here, let's do a little test. Now, obviously, I can't show you how binoviewers work through this single camera, but I can simulate it. Now, I know some of you can't see stereograms, but this is a really short test, so please bear with me. Here are 2 videos of the moon taken 30 seconds apart from each other. Now hold your finger up in the middle and focus on your finger. As you move it towards your nose, keep looking at your finger, and in the distance you should see a third image of the moon show up in the middle. Now quickly change your focus to that middle image. Does it look more detailed than the individual images? For me it does. Let me know what you saw down in the comments section.
If you're enjoying this video, please gently push the like button. It means the world to little channels like this.
The main lesson in this video is that some binoviewers will work in some telescopes, but not all. The only exception to that rule are parfocal binoviewers like this set from Explore Scientific. With that said, generally speaking, it tends to be a little bit easier for binoviewers to work in refractor-style telescopes as opposed to reflector-style telescopes. It's kind of interesting why that is. Let me show you. Binoviewers work by splitting the incoming light, channeling half of it to one eye and half of it to the other eye. Now, the optics in here is made up of various prisms and lenses. It's much more complicated than this, but I've just drawn this route just to simplify it for this demonstration. The biggest challenge with binoviewers, of course, is this distance between here, where the eyepiece normally would be at the top of the telescope focuser tube, and where they end up in a binoviewer, which is way out here. This distance is about 4 to 6 inches, depending on your binoviewer, and this is actually a physical distance. It's an extra distance that the light has to travel before getting to the eyepieces. Now that is actually a problem. You can imagine holding an eyepiece 4 inches above the focuser tube and trying to reach focus. For most reflectors, that's impossible. Now, a lot of refractors have very long focus tubes that can move very far in and out, so this generally is not a problem for refractor-style telescopes. So how do you use binoviewers in a reflector-style telescope? Well, the most elegant trick
is to use a parfocal or linear binoviewer, like this one from Explore Scientific. They designed the optics in such a way that it actually eliminates this extra visual path. It's like this distance doesn't even exist. In fact, the way that you use this particular one, you don't even use that. You take the eyepiece and you put it in your telescope and you adjust the focus until you get it just right. You pull that out and you put the two eyepieces in here and then you put this in the telescope and it's automatically in focus because, again, this distance doesn't exist optically because it's a parfocal binoviewer. Now, one of these eyepiece tubes does rotate. It allows for fine focus because nobody's two eyes have the exact same focus. Full disclosure, I borrowed these from Explore Scientific, and I have to return them immediately when I'm done recording this video. I was not paid or reimbursed. But what if you can't afford a nice parfocal binoviewer like this, and perhaps you bought a cheaper one that does not account for that extra focal distance? So somehow you're going to have to push this into the telescope by 4 to maybe 6 inches. How are you going to do that in reality? Well, there are 3 main solutions. The most drastic is to move your primary mirror forward several inches to eat up that extra required focus distance. This is complicated and requires modifying your mirror cell, and from that point on, you have a very special purpose telescope that will require using a binoviewer. An easier way is to use a Barlow lens. Now, you might need to experiment with a variety of these to find out which one works for your binoviewer and your telescope. And generally speaking, I found it's actually just this piece at the end. This unscrews, and this will screw in to the end of your binoviewer. As you can imagine, this will also mess with the magnification. And by the way, this Williams Optics binoviewer that I bought secondhand won't work
on my telescopes
with any of the combinations that it comes with out of the box unless I attach an extra Barlow lens that I had to buy separately. Your particular binoviewer may work right out of the box with your telescope, which a lot of people told me this does. So you'll have to contact the customer support and ask them about your specific telescope.
If your telescope tube has these extendable struts, you can try to not go the full extension, holding back about 4 inches. Some telescopes can do this, but some cannot.
Number one, the G-Skyr refractor with a 600 millimeter focal length. Number two, an Intez Maxitov Cassegrain with a 1500 millimeter focal length. Number three, an Orion 8-inch Dobsonian reflector with a 1200 millimeter focal length.
I bought these on eBay for about $140. You can get the exact same set from a lot of different sources, including Amazon. And by the way, these do not come with eyepieces. This binoviewer arrived in this box, and I have to say, they're pretty cheap. It did come with 3 attachments. The first, by default, is this hollow barrel. You see right there, it's 1¼ inches and should fit in any modern telescope. And it is threaded for accessories. It also came with a 1.85x Barlow, and it came with a 3x Barlow as well. Now, the straight-through barrel didn't work on any of my telescopes, but then I decided to attach the 1.85, and of course, this is a different thread. That won't go in there. I don't know why they made those different, but that's okay. So you unscrew the regular straight-through barrel, and you attach the 1.85 like that. And this worked on 2 of my telescopes. By the way, I was using 20 millimeter eyepieces. The 2 telescopes that it worked on were the refractor telescope and the 8-inch Dobsonian telescope, but it did not work on the mak-cass. In fact, even when I tried the 3X, it didn't work on the mak-cass. Now, with that said, I should mention that the Barlows are actually pretty cheaply made and cause noticeable chromatic aberration. With the moon, I ran into an issue where I couldn't get it all in focus at once. Half the moon would be blurry and half the moon would be in focus. I tried a couple different things, but wasn't able to really totally resolve that. Again, these are cheap and they might work with your particular telescope. Now, another odd thing I found out was that one of the prisms is yellow and the other one is clear. I'll see if I can show you that with this light here. So that prism is yellow and it actually had some spots on it. And of course, this one's clear and doesn't have any problems. So I'm not sure if that's normal or not. It might be. Let me know down in the comments if that's completely normal. Also, an issue I ran into is that the eyepiece lines of sight are not exactly parallel to each other. So when you turn this focuser tube, I found that it slowly cycles in and out of alignment. It's subtle, but it does make it a little bit tricky to get your eyes lined up. I was able to find kind of a sweet spot where they were lined up, and then I just leave them that way. But overall, you know, despite working okay, these have been somewhat frustrating to use. And of course, they bend like regular binoculars to adjust for the distance between the eyes, which is unique for every person. These retail for about $310 right now, but I bought them used for about half that price. What's nice is that this set comes with a couple of eyepieces. Let me move this over here. These are 20 millimeter, 66 degree eyepieces, and they seem pretty high quality from what I've found. Okay, so this comes with, I'm gonna move this out of the way. This comes with a hollow barrel on the front. This is 1.25 inches, so it should work on any modern telescope. It also comes with a 1.6x Barlow that screws on the front. You can't put this on the Binoviewer right there because this uses unique threads. I don't know why they do that, but that's just the way it is. So this screws in there when you need it. Now I have a funny story to tell. Get that out of the way. When I purchased this, the gentleman was very open and very honest. He told me that basically in order to get this to work on his particular telescope, he had to use an accessory that was 3D printed. So try to display this guy. It looks like this is kind of a thread to weird thread adapter, and it had a 3D printed insert, and this Barlow, which isn't marked, would screw into that. Now what he would do is he would unscrew the straight through barrel, and he would screw this into the end like that. Right, so you get something like that. So it would put the Barlow right up against the body. And he said that's what he used to get it to work on his. Unfortunately, in my case, I couldn't get either of these to work. And also, when I took this out and screwed it to the end, I couldn't get it to work on any of my telescopes. So I had a Binoviewer that wouldn't work on any of my telescopes. I did find, though, that if I took the end of a 2X Barlow and screwed this into the end like that, and I found that this did work in the Refractor and the 8-inch Dobsonian. William Optics actually sells a 2X Barlow that's made for this Binoviewer, but as of the time of recording this video, they were sold out for their custom Barlow. So funny story, this Barlow has no markings on it, so I wasn't sure what it was. I didn't know if it was a custom one. I could have probably contacted the person I bought it from, but of course, I didn't do that. What I did was I contacted William Optics and I said, hey, I need to buy the Barlow that goes with this. They sent me this guy, which is actually the same. And so now I have two of these. It's a 1.6x Barlow. I can always keep that around. This is a pretty rock solid Binoviewer, and it bends just like this, just like the other one, to get the intra-eye distance to work. One last thing, the 2x Barlow that I used from that Barlow lens, this is a much lower quality Barlow than the optics that are in this. So that cheap Barlow that I used from another source did kind of hamper the optics in this. But I think if I had the actual 2X Barlow from William Optics, I think this would actually be a pretty solid set. Now again, you'll basically need to do some research online to see if this works for your particular telescope. There's a lot of reviews on this and people seem to love it and it seems to work for their particular telescope. But stock out of the box, it didn't work on any of mine unless I attached the 2X Barlow. So keep that in mind when you're shopping for your Binoviewer. Despite the retail price of $499, these are by far my favorite Binoviewers for several reasons. Of course, one of which is this really nice foam case that they come in. But one of the main reasons is that these are parfocal, which means that they will work in any telescope. They worked in all of my telescopes. Now, I have to temper that with the caveat that they will work in any telescope that the eyepiece itself works in. Because basically, if you can reach focus with your eyepiece, you can reach focus with this Binoviewer. One note of caution, this does not come with any eyepieces. This is what you get, but you get a lot because in order to be parfocal, it has some pretty fancy optics inside. Now, the other Binoviewers were able to adjust the distance between the eyes by bending them like traditional binoculars. This one has this pretty fancy sliding capability, so it actually slides apart. It's pretty viscous, so it'll stay wherever you put it. I have to use the widest setting because apparently I have a pretty big head. The main takeaway is that these parfocal binoviewers from Explore Scientific worked great in all of my telescopes. I didn't have to mess with any Barlows. There was no muss, no fuss. I just stuck this in the telescope and it worked great. And I have to say that they are the clear winner as far as sharp image goes as well. The moon was super crisp all the way across the moon, and I didn't see any chromatic aberration. So if you're looking for the no muss, no fuss solution that's super sharp, this is the set that you want to get. I think these three are a good representative of what you can get between $0 and $500. There are, of course, binoviewers that are way more expensive, but I'll let reviewers with bigger budgets address those. Sadly, it's time for me to return this set of binoviewers back to Explore Scientific. I really appreciate them letting me borrow these for this video. If you have the budget, I highly recommend these. So if you're interested in a cheap accessory that lets you take great astronomy photos with your smartphone, check out this video over here. Now, it's well over 100 degrees here and the camera's about to catch on fire. So thanks for watching, everybody. Clear skies.